You know, that's the hardest thing to explain. I mean, you know, I just finished Pasolini. You know, I had no game plan, bro. You know what I mean? I just sat down and, you know, some ideas, some images started coming to me and I just started putting them down, you know? You know, I mean, it's not a film we usually go into the snow and into the, you know, I mean, it's Siberia. It's not Siberia, but it could be Siberia. You know, dog sleds and Jack London kind of shit. And we're reading a lot of Solzhenitsyn. I was reading a lot of Solzhenitsyn at the time, so maybe that had something to do with it. We're reading Jung's Red Book. That had a lot to do with it. You know, working from like just kind of stream of conscious ideas. I was just putting together things that I wanted to shoot. And then, like, oh, it's almost like a bucket list of things I want to film, you know? And then whatever story is there started emerging. I mean, it's basically your, you know, your road movie, whether it's Ulysses or Easy Rider or, you know, Wizard of Oz, you know, character takes a trip, but you know they're coming home, you know.
Willem Dafoe is so unique and so special in so many ways. I wonder, as someone who's had the privilege of taking him on this journey, if you can talk a little bit about what you think makes Willem...
Well, why do you say that? I'm curious. What makes you say that?
What makes me
what
say
makes
that
Willem... What makes him unique to you?
What makes Willem unique to me? I mean, I guess in the simplest form, his voice, and I mean that in the most profound sense of that word, speaks a language both literally and in a figurative sense, which is powerful, which captures your attention. From the first moments of this film where you just hear his voice, you are, as an audience, you are as someone going on a story journey, you are hooked. You are part of his narrative because he makes you part of his narrative. And I think that's, for me, what makes him very special, because not all performers can do that. That's a rare gift. I guess maybe if you can talk a little bit about particularly some of the scenes in this film where Willem is literally having a conversation with himself and how maybe those gifts equipped him to uniquely bring life to those scenes.
His voice, yeah, he does have a beautiful voice, and the voice is coming from his intelligence and his, you know, his art, you know, his love of art. And that's his art, right? I mean, the actor, their voice is what they are about, you know. Coming from the scenes, you know, in the beginning, I was thinking of this double thing, you know, I mean, it was two guys out in the middle of nowhere, you know, running a bar, basically. It was like a simple idea. But then I started thinking of the idea of the double of who is the other guy. Is the other guy even there? You know, and then I'm thinking, yeah, Willem's got to play the other guy. You know what I mean? In other words, so now we're like playing that game where Willem is more than one person physically, and he's actually confronting himself. And then we play that out to where, you know, he's confronting himself, or he's confronting another character who could be him, or could be his brother, right? I mean, you know, I'm not worried about what it could be. You know, I just was more interested in getting at the heart of some scenes and, you know, filming shit and filming things we don't do. And you know, that's something we really haven't done, a guy acting against himself. So then there's two different characters. Then when it came to playing his father, you know, Willem would do, we would play around with those scenes and like, who's gonna play Willem's father? I mean, you're not gonna find somebody who could, you get what I mean? I mean, he knows his father. Okay, so you're gonna get another actor. We're gonna try to get a different actor and teach him how to play Willem. I mean, it doesn't even make practical sense. You follow what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So that's how we arrived at those things.
one of the things that your films have always done is confronted audiences very directly with very graphic content, both in terms of the violence and the sexuality. And I think that particularly some of the sequences in this film really do that. And it's more jarring because of the juxtaposition with the quietness and stillness of the other scenes. I think it'd be very interesting to hear from you what you feel that element of the filmmaking language, particularly violence and sexuality in its most graphic and real form, what that brings to a story, what that brings to an audience, why it's important.
I mean, that's my upbringing. I mean, you know, you film it the way it is, man, you know. So that's the films that were impressionable. I mean, my idea of what movies are about, that's the language of it, man, you know. And if it becomes, you know, if I happen to be now living in some repressive age and, you know, all films are above the waist kind of shit, you know. I mean, even our young cameramen can't film below the waist. It's like in their DNA, they kind of stop at the chick's belt. You know, I mean, it's like ridiculous. It's really, it's oppressive. It's depressive. So, I mean, it is what it is. I mean, sex is what it is. I mean, what are you going to do? You know, cut to the waterfall? I don't, you know, it's not a... It's just not our thing, dude. You know, in this film, all of it was really for me because, you know, it took a long time to put it together. It was so, you know, it was so strange and abstract even for us, you know, going out into the desert, bringing dogs to the desert, getting fish to talk, you know, going deep into caves, you know, footage from NASA footage from out in the galaxies, you know, the children acting, the you know, this was like the heart of the movie anyway. I mean, you know, I'm putting up there the things I really want to film and really want to see, and you know, what's going to inspire me to even get the camera out. You know, when you do something for so long, you don't want to, things you really want to shoot. I'm not into, at this point, I don't really care less about either the, I don't want to say story, but you know, I don't want to be shooting scenes just to, because I think they need to be in there. You know, follow what I'm saying? It's like most of the time, I mean, I've done it myself. I don't have to point to other films. You know, I've done it myself. I shot a lot of shots that are totally unnecessary and really are only used to get you to the shot that counts. So why not just shoot the shot that you want to shoot? The in-between stuff. You know, we're expressing ourselves. We're making these movies to be shown, to be seen. You know, when film doesn't exist unless somebody's watching it. I mean, the process of the film, our conversation about the film is as important as the scene when we shoot it. You know, I mean, that's what it's all about. You know, London is you know, important place for all of us. And, you know, it's a place that you're going to see the film in the language that we shot it in. You know, nobody's reading it there. You dig? You're hearing it, you know, in a native language. It's a place that's going to show films that are not going to be seen in a lot of other places. It's not, it's unfortunately, you know, it's a platform for movies that this might be the only time and place people are going to see these movies. Okay. So that's just, that alone is important, but you know, we're doing this to share it, you know, and then, London, I would say London is as good as any place, and it's more than that, you know. I went to school in London. I made one of my first professional films as a student with the BBC. Don't even get into how, but, you know, I hustled my way into that gig.